In the 1930s, Maggie Barry's voice and banjo could be heard the length and breadth of Ireland. Outside football matches and in cinema queues, in market squares or on fair days, she was Ireland's best known street singer. She had a truly authentic traditional voice and became an influential part of the London Irish music scene in the early 50s and, as a result, was at the forefront of the folk revival. Maggie, or Margaret as she was known in London, had a unique voice and she left a lasting impression on anyone who had ever heard her.
I heard Maggie Barry before I saw her.
Her voice was like a clarion call.
No apologies for the way she approached the song.
Very natural, completely natural, all stripped away. There was just like what you see is what you get with Maggie Barry.
It was just three chords, whether there was more than three chords in the song or not, didn't matter. She rattled away in the three chords, it was fine.
And when she sang Lagging Love, you know, I've yet to hear anybody surpass her.
And in she come and she was wearing a big, big fur coat. She marched in and the jewellery hanging off her. You know what type? Long hair till her hips, jet black. And tucked away and is this how is this? And I looked. But over the years we were getting presents, stuff sent for birthdays and all that. And I realised this is granny.
If I were king of Erin's Isle and all things at my will, I'd roam through all creation, new comforts to find still. And the comfort I would seek the most, as you will understand.
Margaret Barry was born Margaret Cleary into a gypsy family in Cork in 1917. She was born on New Year's Day. Her father and her maternal uncle and grandfather were all musicians, and Margaret started busking at the age of 14. She left home very soon after that and for the next 20 years was to travel the roads of Ireland.
But you couldn't have a better stage than the street in them days, and especially someplace like Pook Fair, you know, or Ballinasloe or these days. And I mean, I learned my music from my father and mother, but I learned to be able to handle an audience from busking when I was a kid, you know. I mean, my father said, if you can get out there, he says, in the middle of Grafton Street, and you can sing a song, he says, you can handle Carnegie Hall, trust me. And he was right.
I think if you're standing busking on a street, you have to grab the passers-by with something they already know or something that's going to grab them in some shape or form, be it a shepherd's crook or a forked tongue.
To be a street singer, you couldn't afford to do traditional songs because people wouldn't listen to them. They were too intimate and so on. So anything that Margaret Barry did publicly would have been in the pop Irish scene.
When she used to get to Dundalk in the 50s even, they would wait for her and all the shop people would come out the shops and she'd work her way up the town and all the shop girls would come out with the requests written on a piece of paper with throttly bits inside. And then if she didn't know the song, she'd learn it. And loads of her songs came off McNulty Family Records and John McGettigan Records. So songs that she was famous for, this was Flower of Sweet Strabane, If You Ever Go Over to Ireland, The Blarney Stone, these were off the hit records of the time.
Don't you see, it's Mr. Maguire and she's company your sister Kate. But you know very well he owns a barn a little way out of town. With the devil a town in Ireland, but you'll find him nary stone.
Many years ago since I was in Smithfield, and believe me, it was nice at that time too. You wouldn't be in dread of the rain anyway. You could come in and have a cup of tea and have a few old jars now and again to keep the old spirit up. What harm? You have to get the spirit in before you can get the spirit out.
You're playing in Castle Blaney on the street, and at that time there would be a jukebox in some of the restaurants, and the old homing waltz was very popular with the young people. And these people went in and Maggie happened to be singing outside the door, and her music and the banjo strains were coming in through the door, and the proprietor went out and he ordered Maggie away from the door to go up town and sing somewhere else, that she was upsetting his clients.
Maggie was a travelling singer, you never heard a voice so strong. When she sang in Newry Market, the whole town heard her song. And her voice was known from London to the streets of Baltimore, for she sang her songs along a road that was often walked.
So Maggie struck up on her banjo, the Bard of Armagh, up the street, and with the strains of this, the young people thought that it was the old home and waltz, and they got up from the jukebox, and the young man was left with nobody in his bar. And the paper said the next morning, street singer versus jukebox, and street singer won.
On the streets, Maggie was known for singing the well-known songs of the day, the Camellias, but she was also a great custodian of traditional songs like Martha, the Flower of Sweet Strabane, or the Factory Girl. And as a result, she was sought out by folklorists in the pioneering days of field recordings. She was first recorded by Peter Kennedy in Dundalk, and in 1953, she was brought to London by the American song collector Alan Lomax.
I'd use my whole endeavour, and I'd try to work my plan, for to gain my prize and to feast my eyes on the flower of sweet Strabane.
In London, along with other notable musicians like Seamus Ennis and Felix Doran, and the Sligo fiddle player Michael Gorman, with whom she was to form a lasting partnership, Maggie became a regular at the sessions in the Bedford Arms pub in Camden Town, which are now recognised as having been hugely important in the development of traditional Irish music.
The East End of London is populated by the London Irish, and they were the survivors of the famine who came over in the 1850s, but they were fourth, fifth generation Irish, and this London Irish group were all Cockneys, and they would have loved her. If they'd heard her singing an Irish song, they'd have all put down their tools and they would have listened to her and paid her money, because they were also sentimentally Irish, which isn't quite the same as being Irish.
Maggie's singing would entertain people, make them comfortable, give them an image of nostalgic things like a whitewashed cottage. One of the songs was the cottage with the horseshoe round the door.
When I think of days of being round that little island of green, it's the cottage with the horseshoe or the door.
You see, when these sessions started up in London, you'd have say a Kerry fiddle player, for example, sitting next to a Donegal fiddle player, but they had a very little in common in their repertoire. Now, in Margaret's case, because she was a traveller and she'd moved all over Ireland, she had soaked up influences all over the place, and her repertoire wasn't confined to a Cork repertoire. She'd pick up songs wherever she went. She was a revelation in London.
Together with Michael Gorman, her popularity and her fame spread, so much so that she now frequently returned to Ireland to play. Only now she wasn't only playing on the streets.
I remember Maggie Barry in Newry Town Hall, and she'd played around it often enough. She'd played it in the market, she played it in the Mall, she played at the Stone Bridge, but in Newry Town Hall she was superb, you know, she'd just sit back and tune up the banjo to a satisfaction which seemed right, and then just blasted out the songs.
I was playing with the Dubliners down in Cork one time, and Ronnie met her on Patrick Street. She was busking, and we were playing in the Savoy Cinema that night, and because she came along with Ronnie, and we got her onto the stage, and to huge applause, of course. And she sang a couple of songs with us, and we had the honour of accompanying her.
The legend of Margaret Barry, or the Queen of the Gypsies as she was now known, began to grow along with the myths. Some of these were of her own making, some were created by publicists, some of them might even have been true.
As I was walking down the road, I spied a court and meet a boar, heart o' swinging open wide, welcome to the field.
She had this facility, and we all have it in different kind of ways, but she had it in a very, very grand manner. She had the charm of being able to reinvent her life. She said her grandfather was the man who invented steam and then turned it into an engine, but first of all, a kettle. The storytelling she did in song was as good as the storytelling she did when she was having a conversation with you. You knew that she was telling it to you for her own adornment and also for entertainment as well.
The singing tinker lady, I think she was known as at the time. I think that was that used to be in the ads, you know, Margaret Barry, the singing tinker lady.
1960, when she comes over, the press handouts go out to the British National Press, and she went up the Mall in a pony cart and gets to the gates of Buckingham Palace and hands in an address from the Queen of the Tinkers to the Queen of Britain.
She is, in the real sense of the word, a living legend, and I'm absolutely delighted to be able to welcome her here. Ladies and gentlemen, Margaret Barry.
And I used to have a little bag, nice little bag, a handy bag, that'd carry about a dozen of small Guinness. And I'd have to bring that to the dance halls and have a little opener in here. And I enjoyed myself there because there was nothing else, only these dance halls. So then I done that constantly through Ireland, and then the loungers came back. Pub grub. The singing, the dancing, the drinking, the music and the lot. She had the whole thing, the combination together. It was grand. I was thrilled at that I didn't have to be bringing the bloody parcel of Guinness.
She used to drink the large bottles of stout, you know, and she'd never go near the top shelf until the end of the night. She might have one or two, but she'd drink bottles of stout till the crows come home, you know. I often remember she'd drink my father and Brenda being under the table, and the Brazen Head, one, especially one evening. I think they all had to come out to get air, the surface, you know, because the Brazen Head only sold bottles, they didn't sell draft. And like with the gas, the boys would be thrown into their neck, and Margaret was in the corner just shoveling this stuff in, you know. And like, my father came out for us and he couldn't take anymore. Like, and Brendan came out and he was falling all over the place. And Margaret came out with the banjo on her back and she turned down to my father and she says, "Are you men right? Come on," says she, "we're going up to Dunahouse." And my uncle says, "Well, no, we're not, I'm going home." And the last thing I saw was Brendan being sitting in the pile on the side of the road and Margaret walking off with her banjo on her back, you know.
When she got on stage, she'd be playing the vamp behind Michael. And then it was time for her song, and she'd get up and she'd be quite shy and wouldn't look, and she'd be tuning the banjo. And she'd play the banjo, the introduction to the song, and then look up into the ceiling and sing the song with this faraway look. And she would have a fixed expression and her head would go back, and she'd absolutely captivate the audience. So she wasn't a brazen sort of extrovert. She was really quite an introvert, but when she sang, she gave everything and it just came out, filled the hall.
As I went a walking one fine summer's morning, the birds in the branches, they sweetly did sing. The lads and the lasses together were sporting. going down to yon factory, their work to begin.
Apart from her unique voice, what made Maggie stand out was her banjo playing.
The banjo wasn't an instrument women played. Maggie Barry was unique in a female, a woman in Ireland playing the banjo. It was totally unusual. And to sing Goodbye, Making Goodbye Pat and play the banjo, I mean, women just didn't do that.
I met her for the first time, I think in the mid-80s, at a benefit concert for the Miners in Downpatrick. At that concert, I remember her, before she went on stage, she started to tune the banjo, and then she said, we'll tune it up later.
Maggie wouldn't have been particularly worried if it wasn't totally in tune. She used to say, I'll pull itself in once it get going. It would too, in a way. You know, she played a banjo like, it was, she carried it around as much as a walking stick or an old friend.
You couldn't imagine her playing a Spanish guitar and all, or an accordion even, you know, it's just part of her. And some people just find the instrument that complements their voice, you know. It's kind of almost a chemical thing, kind of a cohesion, you know. I think she had it with the banjo.
She would have looked upon the banjo, I think, as an accessory. You know, she just headed the odd scalp and maybe play even a bit of melody now and again, and then get back to where she always was, right in the heart of the song.
Far away from the sound of the factory bell.
What song have you in mind? I've a thousand songs. Will you give him down Brownie Stone? To Bendon one morning in July. She met a lovely collie and she smiled as she passed by. He says, I am a stranger and I'm lonely all alone. Would you kindly tell me where I'd find my little Blarney Stone?
Margaret was rated up with the top traditional and folk singers in the world. And as a result of the work she had done in London, she and Michael became a part of the international folk scene of the early 60s, along with people like Joan Baez, Bob Dylan, Pete Seeger and the Clancy Brothers.
They went and did the folk festivals, but they were treated in a different sort of way by intellectual American folkies. And they were seen as folk music, whereas before they'd been seen as Irish music. So they actually had a change of sort of attitude and image, I suppose.
She told me she toured with Bob Dylan and Joan Baez, and I said, well, she toured with Bob Dylan. And then she produced the poster, and there she was on the same bill as Bob Dylan, Joan Baez and Margaret Barry. So she did.
Michael Gorman died in 1970, bringing to an end a long partnership. Maggie soon returned to Ireland to live, although she continued to tour abroad. It must have been hard for her travelling on her own, because she very soon took up with fiddle player Maura Ní Chathain O'Molla.
Granny was living in the Brazen Head in Dublin, and she advertised for a manager. And she got a guy called Pat O'Brien, and him and his wife managed her for a few months. But Maura played the violin and eventually got Granny to do like a partnership, which I didn't think was suitable for Granny.
Margaret was very innocent, you know, and she would have taken up with anybody who made her an offer to go and entertain people.
We want to show you now what we've done.
What the dancing fiddlers did up to the last century now.
Centuries, years.
So we'll try and dance a home, but and fiddle as we do something.
I And the first time I saw them, I thought it was a very, very absurd combination.
But Granny went along with it. And then the work stopped, basically. It ran out within a couple of years.
I travelled an awful lot. And I'm intended to travel more. If I can hold out. Naturally, you know, I'm getting into the years now. And I don't mind one bit. If I can sing an old song, mm-hmm. I'll be still at it anyway and on the move.
Farewell, my own dear native land, for here I cannot stay. I am prepared to sail away, bound for America, to leave the land that gave my birth. It grieves my heart full sore. So fare thee well, dear Ireland, where the three-leaved shamrock grows. The ship she lies at anchor, being now ready for to sail.
Even when I started to look after her when she was sick, she was some crack. Unbelievable. You know what I mean? Even when the night she died, she said to me, and this was maybe 2 a.m, she was ill. We had got the priest, whatever. He talked to her, give her whatever. And she said to me, are you all right? And I says, yeah, I'm all right. I was tearful. Because, you know, they told me that she was going to die. She just looked, she says, if you die once, you'll not die a second time. Do you know what I mean? She wasn't one bit afraid. She had a good life, full life, and didn't bother in the least. And she died at 4 o'clock that morning.
Tears flow freely from my eyes, my heart suppressed with woe. To think I'd leave my native land or be compelled to go.
Since she died in 1989, the legend and the legacy of Margaret Barry continues to grow. She went from playing the streets of Ireland to performing on some of the greatest concert stages in the world. She made many recordings, but most of all, Margaret Barry played a vital role in the development of traditional Irish music.
She was the first one to put her foot up there on a stage, you know, with a totally alien instrument, you know, and sing a completely beautiful Irish song, you know, that had never been done in that style before, you know.
She had a very rich life. In spite of the poverty in which she existed, from time, she had a very rich life because she threw her own being into it.
And she says, I've travelled millions and millions and millions of miles, she says. Millions. Certainly did too. Maybe not physically, but in other ways.
Maggie Barry was a lovely woman and a real lady. A pleasure to be with always.
A nice woman, a happy person who brought light into people's lives.
It's hard to part with all I love that's in my heart, you know. So fare thee well, dear Ireland, where the three-leaved shamrock grows.
Phil Campbell Songbirds. CD available now.